Dr. Mohammed Imran, Senior Lecturer, Department of Oral and Maxillofacial Surgery, Sri Rajiv Gandhi College of Dental Sciences and Hospital. The topic for today's session is mandibular fractures. In maxillofacial trauma, the mandible is the most common facial fracture after the nasal bone. Mandible fractures in maxillofacial trauma occur commonly due to the prominence of the mandible and the comparative lack of the bony and the soft tissue support. For today's session are the surgical anatomy of the mandible, the definition of fracture, etiology, classification, clinical features, and the radiological investigations that are involved in mandibular fractures. Coming firstly to the surgical anatomy. Mandible is best defined as a long bone that is bent into the shape of a horseshoe. Now, mandible fractures occur twice as often as midface fractures. Coming to the parts of the mandible, we have a body, we have two perpendicular rami, the coronoid and the condylar process. These are the parts of the mandible. We have a symphysis, a body, angle, ramus, coronoid and the condylar process, and the alveolar portion of the mandible, this being the alveolar portion of the mandible. There are certain areas of weaknesses in the mandible. By areas of weaknesses, what we mean is areas that are more prone to fracture when they receive a blow or a force on them. These areas are the mental protuberance. This is the mental protuberance. We have the mental foramen. This constitutes one area of weakness. The mandibular angle and the condylar neck. Okay, so these are the areas that constitute the areas of weakness along the mandible. Now, there are certain muscles that are attached to the mandible, mainly the muscles of mastication. We have the lateral and the medial pterygoid, temporalis, and the masseter muscle. Now, the masseter muscle, as you can see, it attaches to the lateral surface of the ramus of the mandible. The temporalis inserts onto the coronoid process. The lateral pterygoid, which is in blue, attaches to the neck of the condyle, and the medial pterygoid, this one attaches to the medial surface of the ramus of the mandible. And we have some suprahyoid muscles as well, the suprahyoid muscles being the geniohyoid, mylohyoid, and the digastric. These three muscles mainly attach to the mandible. Now, the importance of these muscles in fractures is that they exert a muscle pull on the fractured segment, causing the displacement of the fracture. We'll have a look at that as we go ahead. So, coming firstly to the definition of the fracture, a fracture may be defined as a sudden, violent solution of the continuity of the bone, which may be complete or incomplete. Etiology: the motor vehicle accidents being the most common cause of mandibular fractures worldwide, followed by assaults, work or sports related injury, as you can see in case of boxing or in case of a cricket where the person is hit by a ball, falls, projectile missiles, and pathologic fractures such as in cases of ameloblastoma or odontogenic cyst, etc. So, coming to the incidence of mandibular fractures, the most frequently fractured is the body of the mandible, followed by the condyle, the angle of the mandible, the symphysis or the parasymphysial region, the coronoid, and the dentoalveolar fractures being the least common. Coming to the classification of mandibular fractures, there are various classifications that have been given depending upon the nature of the fracture, depending on the anatomic region: Kazanjian and Converse classification, Rowe and Killies, Kruger's, Kruger and Chili, and based on the muscle pull, whether it is a favorable or an unfavorable fracture and the AOMSI classification. We'll have a look at few of these classifications. Firstly, based on the nature of the fracture, they can be classified into simple or closed, compound or open, comminuted, green stick, pathologic, multiple, impacted, atrophic, indirect, complicated or complex. Coming firstly to the simple and compound type of fractures. A simple fracture is a one that does not penetrate through the skin. Okay, a simple fracture does not penetrate through the skin, and a compound fracture is the one that penetrates through the skin, as you can see, and it communicates with the external environment. So in a simple fracture, there is no communication with the external environment, and in a compound fracture, there is a communication with the external environment. Comminuted is when the bone is splintered into multiple pieces. Green stick fracture is more commonly seen in pediatric patients or younger individuals, as you can see here. In a green stick fracture, the one cortex is fractured. For example, the buccal cortex is fractured and the lingual cortex is intact. So it's an incomplete type of fracture. Multiple fractures where there is more than one fracture, as you can see here, there is a fracture of the parasymphysis and the angle region. Pathological fracture is when there is a pathology, as you can see here. There is a pathology here. Now this pathology can be a cyst, it can be a tumor. Now whenever the mandible is weakened by a pathology like this, it becomes easier for the mandible to fracture on receiving a slight blow. Coming to the Dingman and Natwick classification, that is a classification based on the anatomic region of the mandible. It is divided into the parts of the mandible, that is the midline, the parasymphysis, body, angle, ramus, coronoid and the condylar process and the alveolar process of the mandible. The Kazanjian and Canvas classification, now this is based on the presence or absence of serviceable teeth on either line of fracture. It is divided into class 1 if the teeth are present on both sides of fracture line, class 2 if the teeth are present only on one side, and class 3 is edentulous patient. So as you can see here, class 1, the fracture is present here in the midline. There is presence of teeth on both sides of fracture line, so it is class 1. In class 2, you can see that on one side of the fracture, that is on this side, the patient is edentulous. So teeth are present only on one side of the fracture line, so thereby it is class 2. And in class 3, there is absence of teeth on both the sides, and thereby it is classified as class 3. Kruger and Schilly's classification, it is a comprehensive classification that combines the previous classifications that we came across. That is, in relation to the external environment, as we saw, the fracture can be classified into simple and compound. And depending upon the type of fracture, it can be classified into in an incomplete, green stick, complete or comminuted, where it is splintered into multiple segments. Depending upon the presence of dentition, it can be divided into a sufficiently dentulous jaw, edentulous or insufficiently dentulous jaw, primary or mixed dentition. Depending upon the localization, that is the anatomic region of the fracture, it can be divided again into, as we already have seen in the Dingmans and Natwicks, into symphysis region, canine, body, angle, ramus, coronoid and condylar process region. Now depending upon the muscle pull the muscles exert on the mandible, for example, the masseter and the medial pterygoid exert an upward and an inward pull. Lateral pterygoid muscle attaching to the neck of the condyle exerts a medial pull. Temporalis that attaches to the coronoid process has its origin on the temporal bone, thereby it exerts an upward pull. Geniohyoid and the digastric muscles which attach to the hyoid bone exert a downward pull. So these are the muscle forces that are acting on the mandible at different points. So thereby when there is these muscles come into play. Now based on the effect of this muscle pull on the fracture segments, the fractures can be divided into favorable and unfavorable fractures. And further, they can be divided into fractures that are vertically favorable and unfavorable, and fractures that are horizontally favorable and unfavorable. Coming to the horizontally favorable and unfavorable fractures, as you can see in the image on the left side, the fracture line is running in a downward and an anterior direction. The fracture line is running in a downward and an anterior direction. So the direction of the fracture line is such that it resists the displacement of the fracture segment. As you can see, as indicated by the arrow, the fracture trying to displace upward and inward is resisted by this segment, which prevents the displacement of the mandible. So thereby this type of fractures are referred to as favorable fractures. And on the right side, as you can see, it's running in an opposite direction, that is the fracture line is running in a downward but a posterior direction. Thereby, as indicated by the arrows, whenever there is a fracture running in a downward and posterior direction, the muscle pull causes the displacement of the fracture. So thereby this becomes an unfavorable type of a fracture. So coming to vertically favorable and unfavorable fractures, now this can be identified using an occlusal radiograph. Horizontally favorable and unfavorable fractures can be identified using an orthopantomogram. So for vertically favorable and unfavorable fractures, we'll use an occlusal view. A vertically favorable fracture is the one in which the fracture line runs from the outer buccal plate, that is here, from the outer buccal plate obliquely backwards and lingually. This way the fracture line, as you can see, is running obliquely backward and lingually. Thereby what happens is when this segment tries to displace medially, the other segment, it resists the displacement of the fracture segment. So thereby it is called as a favorable fracture. Whereas in an unfavorable, the fracture line runs from the inner lingual plate obliquely backward and buccally. As you can see, the fracture lines are running in an opposite direction in favorable and unfavorable fracture. And when the fractured segment displaces, it will displace medially without any resistance. So this is an image that is showing an horizontally favorable fracture. As you can see, as indicated by arrows, the muscle is exerting an upward pull and the fracture is trying to displace upward and medially because of the masseter and the medial pterygoid muscle. But the segment anteriorly, that is this segment, is preventing the displacement of the fracture. Thereby it is a favorable fracture. Similarly, vertically favorable fracture, as you can see by the arrows, the lateral and the medial pterygoid muscle are exerting a medial and inward pull, whereas the fractured segment is itself preventing the displacement of the fracture. So these are the favorable fractures. Now coming to the examination and the diagnosis aspects of mandibular fractures. Immediate assessment of and treatment of any condition constituting a threat to life. Now this mainly refers to the airway management and bleeding which cause an immediate threat to life. Then it is followed by general clinical examination. After that, the local examination of the mandibular. So as I said, immediate assessment and treatment of any condition constituting a threat to life includes mainly establishment of a safe airway and the control of severe bleeding. Airway management can be done using either a oropharyngeal, nasopharyngeal airway, laryngeal airway mask, or more commonly as it is used, endotracheal intubation. This is followed by general clinical examination. Thorough evaluation of injuries elsewhere to the body has to be checked, because a blow that was of enough intensity to fracture a mandible is also capable of fracturing other bones in the body. So, no operative procedures should be carried out to treat a fracture until the operator is certain that the patient has not sustained any additional and a more serious injury. This is followed by recording a history. You will first ask what is the cause of fracture, whether it is a motor vehicle accident, whether it's an assault, a fall, etc. Whether the patient was wearing a protective helmet or a seat belt if it was a motor vehicle accident. Direction of force. For example, if the patient falls on the chin, you will commonly see a symphyseal fracture along with bilateral condylar fracture. Whereas if a patient receives a blow to the parasymphysis, you may see a parasymphysial and a contralateral angle fracture. So the direction of force gives you an idea about the type of fracture that you may be treating. If the teeth were clenched at the time of injury, dento-alveolar fractures you will come across in this type of cases. If the blow was from a broad or from a sharp object, a broad object will cause multiple fractures, whereas a sharp object will cause penetrating type of injuries. Any medical history, if the patient is suffering from any known conditions such as diabetes, hypertension, etc., and if preliminary treatment in the form of tetanus and any other medications were prescribed to the patient. So coming to the clinical examination, now the clinical examination can be divided into inspection and palpation. Now we will have a look at it into two parts, that is extraoral inspection and extraoral palpation, intraoral inspection and intraoral palpation. Coming firstly to the extraoral inspection, contour and swelling. If the patient is having any swelling, as is evident, the patient is having a swelling on the left side of the face. Any lacerations and soft tissue loss if it is present. If the mouth opening is normal or if it is restricted is what we will have a look, because different fractures have an effect on mouth opening. For example, a depressed zygomatic arch fracture which impinges on the coronoid process of the mandible may reduce or restrict the mouth opening. Any deviation on mouth opening if it is present, and the vertical height of the ramus if it is normal. Coming next to extraoral palpation, we will mainly look at two things when we are doing an extraoral palpation. We will look at any step deformity if it is palpable, and any tenderness, that is pain. If you are palpating, if the patient has pain in any particular region, it has to be noted down. Intraoral inspection, we will look at occlusion, midline shift, ecchymosis in the floor of the mouth, which is referred to as a Coleman sign, swelling of the tongue or nasopharynx if it is present, any intraoral bleedings, and if the fracture communicates with the external environment, whether it is simple or a compound fracture. So these are some of the classical signs that you will come across. Bilateral condylar fracture will result in a classical anterior open bite, as you can see in the top two images. And in the lower image, you can see that there is a fracture of the parasymphyseal region, and this segment is pulled upward because of the muscle pull. So thereby there is a premature contact here, that is the premature contact of the teeth on the ipsilateral side, resulting in a contralateral open bite. This is a Coleman sign, that is the sublingual ecchymosis, which I spoke to you in the previous slide, one of the classical signs of the mandibular symphyseal or parasymphyseal fracture. This is followed by intraoral palpation, where you will check for tenderness in the buccal vestibule of both the sides, feel for any step, if any tooth mobility is present, and dento-alveolar segment mobility. This is something called as a bimanual palpation. As you can see, there is a parasymphyseal fracture. So you will place your thumb on the lower border of the mandible and your index finger on the teeth, and you will try to move the segments and see if there is any, if you can elicit the movements. This is called as bimanual. Once we arrive at the provisional diagnosis using the clinical examination, we will advise a certain investigations that will help us achieve or arrive at the final diagnosis. Now these investigations are an IOPA, OPG, lateral oblique view, PA view, occlusal view, reverse Townes view, and also we can use a CT scan. Now this is a lateral oblique view of the mandible. You can see on the left side there is a body fracture, as you can see here. You can see a fracture line that is running from the premolar downwards and involving the lower border of the mandible. And then on the right side, you can see there is an angle fracture here. A fracture line is running involving the impacted tooth, and the fracture line is running this way involving the lower border of the mandible. So that indicates an angle fracture. As the definition says, it is a discontinuity in the bone. You can see a radiolucent line that indicates a fracture on the radiograph. As you can see here as well, these are occlusal radiographs showing a fracture. This is a displaced fracture here. Similarly, an undisplaced fracture you can observe. This is an orthopantomogram which we commonly use in the dental setup. You can see that there is a body fracture in one of the cases as depicted here. The same image has been zoomed, indicative of a body fracture. There are two fracture lines. If you observe, you can see it may not be indicative of two separate fractures. There may be two fracture lines running on the buccal and the lingual cortex that appears as two separate fracture lines on the radiograph. Similarly, you can see a parasymphysial fracture in the lower orthopantomogram running between the lateral incisor and the canine region, and again marked by arrows for you to identify. This is a posterior-anterior view of the skull, where you can see the angle on the right side of the mandible is fractured. And then we have the CT scans and 3D reconstructions which help us diagnose the fractures. Now a CT scan, we have three views. That is, we have a coronal view. A coronal view looks something like this. And then we have a sagittal view, and then we have an axial view. Axial view is this one, and this on the right side what you see is a 3D reconstruction of the skull and the mandible. So we'll just try to identify the fractures that are seen on this 3D scan. So coming first to the axial view that is present on the left side, okay, we have an angle fracture that is indicated by a white arrow here on the left side. Okay, this arrow indicating the angle fracture that is present, and this arrow indicating a body fracture that is undisplaced. The coronal view, these are the two condylar processes that have been fractured and displaced medially. And then we have a 3D reconstruction that depicts all the different fractures that are seen on the skull mandible. Different radiographs can be used for identifying different fractures in particular. For example, dentoalveolar fractures are best seen using an IOPA. Occlusal radiographs can be used for symphysis and body region. It is mainly to assess the buccolingual direction of the fracture line. OPG can be used for all type of fractures. And CT scans again can be used for all type of fractures. And reverse Townes view is mainly used for diagnosing a subcondylar fracture. So with this, I'll conclude my class for today. And in the next class, we'll have a look at the management of the mandibular fractures. Thank you.